Great Scott!
The Great Scott Show.
And as they head into the final furlong, all of the other radio stations and radio hosts are left in the wake of a keen turn of speed by the Great Scott Show, the champion!
With Scott Prather.
Steal the show.
Welcome in to the Great Scott Show on a
Gimme All You Got
Friday, 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time. What's happening, everybody? It's cold out there. Good Lord. Oof. Sheesh. It's freezing. Stay warm, everybody. Stay warm. It's going to be cold today in Shreveport. I know that much. The Independence Bowl coming your way. We're, what, 7 hours away from kickoff? 5 hours away from pregame? Louisiana versus Houston today. 12 o'clock pregame, 2 o'clock kickoff. We will have plenty on the Independence Bowl, especially in the 8 o'clock hour. I will visit with Louisiana Ragin' Cajun running back, kick returner Chris Smith before he plays his final game as a Cajun today. I will visit with Louisiana Ragin' Cajun defensive tackle Zi'Yon Hill-Green before he plays his final game in a Cajun uniform today. And I will visit with quarterback Chandler Fields, who will be starting under center for the Cajuns today. That's coming up. Also, Cody Junot, sideline reporter, going to join me for a little Cajun football talk as well. Gus Kattengell, Saints and Pelicans correspondent, is going to come on. We'll talk Saints. We'll talk Pels. We'll talk about Jayden Daniels deciding to come back to LSU next season and why I think that's a really good thing for the Tigers. But before we do that, sometimes you just got to embrace evolution. You got to. Now, when the NFL Sunday ticket package was sold or reported was going to be sold to Google to be distributed through YouTube, there was a small part of me that was disappointed, not surprised, because I was hoping it would be Apple because then I could buy it. I don't feel like buying YouTube TV, all that other stuff. But, you know, there's a lot of chatter of, oh, why are they getting away from satellite? Why are they getting away from cable? Because it's called evolution. When the NFL is like, we're going to just have Thursday night football be streaming only. That was a big moment. That was a big moment. You had cable and satellite. And then the streaming era started. And a lot of people started cutting the cord. Yours truly, I did it. But the NFL is such a monster. Is such a mover and shaker in this country, and Google buying this Sunday ticket package being distributed on YouTube is the biggest game changer ever in the history of streaming television. YouTube becomes legitimate, but how many people in other markets would buy DirecTV just so they could have Sunday ticket, just so they could watch their favorite team? How many folks would buy DirecTV just so they could have Sunday ticket, just so that they could watch all the games? There's somebody in another market that's a huge Saints fan that says, I don't feel like going to the bar every day. I live in California. I don't want to go watch games at 10 a.m. I want to watch it right here on my couch. And guess what? DirecTV, see ya. I'm getting YouTube TV. I don't know how this streaming thing works, but guess what? Now I'm going to figure it out. I'm finally going to figure it out because I have to, because I got to see my team play. Evolve. Evolve. I used to complain about, you know, a totally another note as we get ready to bring on Gus Kattengell. I used to complain a lot about the Mets ownership, the Wilpons being, you know, this. Just, I didn't like them, okay? I didn't like them. And then Steve Cohen bought the team, and I was like, this is good. Deep pockets, wants to pay. Now the Mets, who haven't won a World Series since I was 4 years old, are the big enemy in Major League Baseball. Because Steve Cohen is just a huge payroll. The signing of Carlos Correa, we've talked about it. It was unprecedented. Justin Verlander, all of this stuff. You sign a star player. You sign a somewhat controversial player. He doesn't care if the Mets become a big villain in baseball like the Yankees have been, although the Yankees have a lot more supporters. You know, the Yankees are kind of the Cowboys of MLB. The Cowboys are kind of the Yankees of the NFL. I don't quite know yet what the Mets are, but we're talking about evolving. They're evolving into something under Steve Cohen. And I think it's going to be a team that a lot of other fan bases don't really like. Some of you are like, yeah, we already feel that way. Yeah, some of you have just been indifferent about the Mets, if you're being honest, but Steve Cohen's going to change all that. Anyway, it's Independence Bowl Day. We're going to talk with Chris Smith, with Chandler Fields, with Zi'Yon Hill-Green, with Cody Junot. We're going to talk with Gus Kattengell next. Happy Friday, everybody. Stay warm.
GIMMEE ALL YOU GOT! GIMMEE ALL YOU GOT!
It's the Great Scott Show at GIMMEE ALL YOU GOT Friday on 103.3 The GOAT. Simulcast on 1420 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time. Back into the Great Scott Show on a Gimme All You Got Friday. Yes, indeed. It is Bowl Day. Independence Bowl coming up at 2 o'clock today. Our coverage begins at noon. Pre-game show. I will be chatting with a number of Raging Cajuns this morning. Coming up around 8 o'clock, I will visit with running back Chris Smith, who declared for the will declare for the NFL draft officially after today's game. He said he wasn't going to miss today's game. Quarterback Chandler Fields and another guy that will declare for the NFL draft but wanted to play this game too. That being Zi'Yon Hill-Green. It means something to him, man. They want to be in it. But we're going to spend some time talking a little Saints and Pels right now with our Saints and Pelicans correspondent, Gus Kattengell. But Gus, man, I mean, you know, in the day and age we live in 2022, a lot of players, you know, they're thinking long term. I don't want to get hurt in a game. I get it. But, you know, when guys are like, I ain't missing this game. You know, I mean, Bryce Young, I'm not missing this game. I mean, to shout out to the Bama guy. Like, I think it says something, man. I don't think when a guy sits out, it necessarily hurts their stock if they're good enough. But I do think there's something, you know, on the flip side, I think scouts, especially if it's a player that's not, you know, a bona fide first rounder, it's like, all right, he wanted to be out there with his teammates. It meant that much to him, and the game means that much to him. I think that can help a little bit with scouts too, don't you think?
I do, and I think, you know, a lot of what you've seen recently too is understanding, and it's a topic every year now, is, you know, when players started opting out of bowl games and deciding whether or not they should play or not for risk of injury. And look, you look at, you know, Matt Corral last year, during the Sugar Bowl, he gets injured early on, and you wonder if that would affect, you know, where he would have been drafted or not. And, you know, look, that is the risk you have. I think obviously in football, I mean, it could happen on any play that you can get injured. And I do think maybe having NIL money for some of these players does matter. It helps. But like you said, not everybody has those NIL deals that are six or seven figures or something like that nature. And I go back to what Jayden Daniels, you know, said earlier this week about why he wanted to come back. He said he wasn't ready to get off that ride, you know, and playing in front of 102,000 or enjoying that as well. Now, look, I think there's football reasons to that, right? And it proves his draft stock. Probably the day he gets drafted, as they come back to a very talented NFL, I mean, blatant sort of team potentially, right, with the Tigers. So I think there's football reasons, and then there's also like he intimated, Joe, and a lot of these players do. They understand it's going to be different once you're done, right? It's a job all of a sudden. You're not guaranteed anything. If you're really good, you're going to a bad team. It's something that you've said in the past, Scott, that you're going to go up. I can tell you LSU's facilities and nutrition is probably better than the Saints. It's not probably. I would put it better. I mean, I've been in the LSU training facility and the video room and all that stuff, and their weight room is 15 times the size of the Saints have. So I just think you're seeing that a little bit more from a lot of players. And yet, look, you have a lot of players that are opting out. I mean, Purdue basically has anybody and everybody that's a top player for them opting out. Quarterback, running back, cornerback, tight end, receiver. You know, from that standpoint, now their coach left, so they viewed it as, you know, why go ahead and play that game that it could affect their draft. I think fans are always going to want to see their players play, right?
And I'm with you. They are, and I do think that, like, 10 years ago, a lot of fans wouldn't have respected a player who decides not to, but I think in 2022, fans, they respect the player's decision when they say, I'm not going to. Not all, but I think a lot more than, say, 10 years ago. But while those same fans respect that, they really appreciate the ones that are like, I'm doing it. You know, and that's something that I'm going to talk to Chris Smith and Zi'Yon Hill-Green about next hour. Like, what went into that decision? Because, you know, as an outsider, you're like, what? You have a lot to lose, but you're also not in that locker room. You don't know the relationship they have with those players, with the fan base, and all that other stuff. So it means a lot to them. You know, that's what it tells me. It means
it's
a whole lot to them.
It's a mindset, too, Scott. I mean, it's a mindset, too. I've heard from players so often, right, that if you – I mean, Alvin Kamara said it last week for the Saints, that if you go into a game thinking you're going to get hurt or you're worried about – this or that, that's when it happens. And he was talking about specifically about playing on. He's like, you go into a game not playing on, that's when you get hurt. So it's a mindset. I mean, it's a mentality to go out there and do that. And to your point, for a lot of these guys, going out and putting a bold performance, that absolutely can help you, right? Because a lot of times you're the only game at that time. A lot of times you're the only game that's on. A lot of times, more than often than not, it's going to be on ESPN, so it's nationally televised. And, you know, people from the bars to the houses to, you know, whatever, are going to get to watch these Cajun players play, and maybe they never have. You know, maybe they haven't. So, and if they, you know, pull off a big run, an interception or a key pass, it's going to be the highlight of the night. And, you know, it does help. It absolutely does.
Gus Kattengell, I guess. Last thing on college bowl games, and I'll talk pretty much all Independence Bowl in the 8 o'clock hour. You mentioned LSU and the Citrus Bowl and against Purdue, and that's coming up, you know, next week. Jayden Daniels coming back. I think a lot of people expected that, but still, now that he officially is doing it, LSU's returning some O linemen. You know, I know they recruited a number of them. Brian Kelly, I know they're 9-4, and you know, if they win the Citrus Bowl, they get to 10 wins. They won the West, which no one expected. Daniels coming back. I mean, LSU next year, heading into the season, the expectations, I mean, they're always high, Gus, but I think sometimes they're realistically high, and other times they're unnaturally high, if that makes sense. I think they'll be deservedly high next season, because that's big for them. And look, Walker Howard's good, and I do think he's the future at some point. But Jayden Daniels, just especially the second half of the season, that was a big positive for LSU football yesterday when that came out.
Yeah, no doubt about it. I you know, immediately got a phone call from somebody that was like, I don't like this. It's Nussmeier and Howard's time. And I honestly just thought,
what?
I'm like,
what?
Did you watch this season?
What?
Because he single-handedly got you the games and got you to the SEC championship game. Like,
what? I'm sorry. I keep saying what, but what?
Dude, I don't know. And again, by no means, please, let me preface this by saying, I don't have any dog in a fight, right? I am not pro this or hate LSU or love it. I'm just, I observe how fans react and are. And Jayden Daniels is a guy that fans across social media, and I understand it's not every LSU fan. But they wanted that guy benched and Brian Kelly fired at halftime against Florida State. We've talked about
it. Yeah.
And I understand that there's this excitement, as you've said it before, the most popular guy is the backup quarterback. You know, the style that Nussmeier plays and, you know, the bravado is going to chunk it and fling it and pray and Favre-like do this. That's great. I don't get it. Like, I mean, the way some fans want him and desire him, I think it's great that he's got that kind of support. I'm all about supporting players like that, but I don't understand how you can't watch Jayden Daniels' season and not just absolutely be impressed.
Yeah.
I've gone on my show and said, if he's there for the Saints to take and to, you know, develop, I would love that, because aside from the physical attributes, which is the guy can score with his legs, the guy can score with his arm, that I love more than anything is the fact that he got better every game. Every single game you saw him improve. You saw him take the coaching. You saw him handle things on and off the field. You saw him handle things on the field where the guy never looked flustered. And you saw that in the first game against Florida State. Like, he just, you know, you didn't see the moment be too big for him during the season. Against Alabama, they scored. He led a driving score. They score in overtime. He led the driving score, delivers the game-winning pass. Like, just calm. You never got the sense of this guy's going to fumble the snap or make the bad read. And for people that can – I get callers. He can't read defenses. I don't understand how you continually tell me that, but the guy threw a beautiful –
Yeah, I kind of see – yeah. I would, you know, I hear stuff like that, and I start having suspicions about those kinds of fans. But
I understand. You're right. That's my point, though. It's like I got that immediately. I'm like, the first thing you should be thinking about if you're an LSU fan is you're returning your offensive line. Your receiving room's going to be a joke. I mean, you got more three five-star receivers, Boutte coming back. Your starting offensive line, a guy who, quite honestly, I was like, after the Bama win, I'm like, that guy's got to be mentioned in top five for Heisman. And you're losing in college football, much less the SEC, quarterbacks of stature that have experience and stuff. Florida's looking for a quarterback. Auburn's having you everything. State, I mean, A&M has the freshman that beat you. But, like, he should be arguably the best quarterback. I mean, Stetson is gone. I mean, who in the SEC is the better quarterback? He's arguably going to be the number one quarterback in the SEC that you have. You're probably going to be favored or it'll be to compete, even though I know Bama got the number one recruiting class again. But still, I mean, I don't know how you can't be happy that he's coming back. And, you know, I saw even Matt Moscone and others pointing out Brody Miller from The Athletic. Look, Walker Howard is a redshirt freshman next year. He's still going to be able to be, you know, a two-year starter for LSU and
or three
go into the NFL and be great.
Possibly.
I don't think he transfers. I do think Nussmeier does.
Probably so. Well, you mentioned the Saints a minute ago. Let's shift gears to that. Gus Kattengell, Saints and Pelicans correspondent. Before we get into Saturday's matchup at Cleveland and injured reserve and all that stuff, one Pro Bowler, the irony that DeMario Davis finally gets in when the Saints are having the season they are. Now, he deserves it. The truth is, he's deserved it several times. I mean, the guy's been a first-team AP All-Pro and yet had never been a Pro Bowler. So, you and I have said it a lot. They don't even really have a game anymore. The game itself doesn't matter. But, you know, it's contract clauses, representation, and just getting your proper due, I think. It was good. Good to see that for DeMario, and you don't have to add a ton to it, Gus. I just didn't want us to not mention him and what he's done, and that, you know, he reminds me of London Fletcher, not in terms of size. I mean, London was smaller, but in that London Fletcher for so many years was one of the best linebackers in the NFL, just would never go to the Pro Bowl. And then later in his career, he finally did, but he had been in the league like over a decade, and then it finally was happening, and it's like, Yeah, it's about time. I mean, the guy's deserved it for a while, and good for DeMario, man. He's more than earned it, not just this season, but I would say pretty much since he joined the Saints, you know, back in 2018.
Yeah, you know, it was funny about the Pro Bowl, too, is like I kind of looked at it this week as well, is that, you know, I mean, Tyrann Mathieu's an alternate, and again, I'm not questioning a guy or ripping him, but I mean, I don't think he's played at a Pro Bowl level in status. A lot of that is about your name recognition and the respect you've had in the past and everything, and I look at it from that perspective when it comes to DeMario Davis, that, you know, finally he at least is getting, as you said, that respect and recognition from the past. I think that leads to the season. I mean, he's obviously been a solid linebacker for the Saints this year, but, you know, I think if healthy, Pete Werner was probably the better one. And that's awesome. That's good to have if you're the Saints, knowing that you got a guy, because you were always worried, right? What if DeMario Davis leaves or his day is done? Like, what do you do? You know, who's the guy that takes over for him? At least you know you're at least set.
I guess. I mean, look, Caden Ellis played well this year. I'd still worry about Werner because while he was great, I mean, the truth is, Gus, he's been injured. And it was the concern about him. Really, it's been the concern about him since he got to New Orleans. Now, what we got to see this
year, the hamstrings, right?
Yeah. And he's out with a hamstring injury. Didn't practice all week. You know, you finally got him back from another injury. I mean, the reality is, while when he's been good on the field, the majority of his tenure with the Saints, he's been injured. I mean, it's just a fact. Now, you got Caden Ellis, and he and DeMario will play, and they're going to need them in a big way for a game Saturday in Cleveland that, you know, the Saints are going to be without Andres Pete. Andres Pete's questionable. They're going to be without Cesar Ruiz. They might be without Pete. You know, they're going to be without Pete Warner. They're going to be without Jane Washington. They're going to be without Jarvis Landry, who now is officially on IR, and it's been a really disappointing season for him, no doubt, and his might be his only year with the Saints. We'll see. But Chris Olave out. I mean, hadn't practiced all week with the hammy. Lattimore and Marcus May questionable. You look at the injury report. Only Jadeveon Clowney is listed as out for Cleveland. You look at how cold that game is going to be on Saturday. You look at the fact that it's probably just, I think if you're the Saints, I think this needs to be the Taysom Hill game. Let him have his most touches in a game this season. I don't think you want to be out there slinging the ball around. Run the football, use Taysom, and I think you're going to need some shenanigans. Is that too strong of a word? You're going to need the ball to bounce your way. I was surprised that Cleveland's only -3, and I get that they're 6-8, but given the injuries, given the style of game this is going to be, and the fact that Cleveland has Nick Chubb, I think he's the best running back in the league. I don't know, man. I hope I'm wrong, but I don't see the Saints winning this thing, man. I don't think the Saints fans are going to get a win in their Christmas stockings come Saturday.
Guys, you're going through the list of players that are available, not available for this week, man. I'm honestly just shaking my head. I'm sure Saints fans are doing the same thing, and I don't even know what you can do about it. I mean, I've had an hour on the show where I'm like, I think it's padding. I think it's, you know, sure, the advancement of players' speed and size. But, I mean, and it's not a Saints problem, right? I mean, there's a lot of key players, good players, number of players for a number of teams in the NFL that are without their guys. But, I mean, it's borderline ridiculous, right? I mean, it's, and look, even with the guys that you do have on the offensive line, I mean, I was talking about it earlier this morning, Ryan Ramczyk, I mean, they've rested him all offseason and during the season. The guy still gets the day. Like, he's never healed, I think, from last year, from that aspect of it. You haven't had the offensive line, you know, intact primarily. I think everybody on that line missed games this year. It's just, I don't know. I don't know how you fix it, man, because the reason I'm even starting there, Scott, is because it does build a narrative that can be very easily looked at as, well, that's why this season didn't succeed under Dennis Allen and his staff. And because you're right. How in the heck is that? That's not even That's not even an NFL roster with the guys that you're talking about that are, you know, missing. I mean, those are substantial losses. And you know what? You still have Lattimore. I mean, like, it could be very easy to say, well, Gus, what do you expect them to do when you don't have a healthy line? This guy's on IR. That guy, I mean, two of your starting top three receivers you thought you had for the season are on IR and the season's done. And Thomas and Landry. Olave's not playing. I mean, like, I hear you. You're absolutely right. You shouldn't win the game on Sunday. But that's my concern, Scott, because I don't know what you can do. Unless stopping short of hiring the Eagles medical staff, because they've gone weeks. I know Jalen Hurts is missing this one, but they literally went weeks where people would just tweet their injury report. It's nobody. You know, it's like it's something. I don't know if it's the off season, if it's me just wanting it to be something. I find it really interesting, you know, that you can't keep anybody healthy on this team. You have misdiagnoses of injuries. I mean, Lattimore's been out forever. Landry in and out. Never seen that he got, you know, healed from his earlier injury in the beginning of the season. Michael Thomas detests the Saints medical staff, you know. So I don't know, Scott. It's crazy, man, because I spent more time this week not even thinking about the matchups of the game, because I think it's almost laughable in a almost sadistic, sad way. It's just like I'm looking at the game wondering over under five, you know, belly bursting laughs in the game. Like I'm expecting the ball snapped off of the helmet that goes into the air that's picked up by Myles Garrett and he scores a touchdown.
Maybe Cleveland can do that. I mean, maybe just the roles can be reversed, and for the first time this season, the Saints could actually win back-to-back games. But I'm not betting on that, my friend. No way. I mean,
right? That's the point. It's crazy. You don't have like that confidence.
The Saints can't. Even when they're winning, it's like, well, they beat the Falcons, and people are like, well, if they hadn't blown that stupid game to Tampa, they'd be in first place, or they almost blew the game against Atlanta.
Right.
It's been that kind of season. We're gonna take a quick timeout. We got Gus for just a little bit longer. Gonna talk about the Pelicans. Some people worried about the recent swoon. I'm not. Don't worry. Everybody, stay tuned. More of the Great Scott Show on Gimme All You Got Friday. Coming up in the 8 o'clock hour, a number of raging Cajuns. We'll visit with Zi'Yon Hill-Green, Chris Smith, and Chandler Fields. Sideline reporter Cody Junot will join me as well. Independence Bowl today at 2. Pregame begins at noon. Don't go anywhere. The Great Scott Show continues after this.
Mic check. Mic check.
Welcome back into the Great Scott Show on a Give Me All You Got Friday, Independence Bowl Day. We are going to talk plenty about that in the 8 o'clock hour. Gus and I talked about it a little bit. Gus Kattengell with us for one more segment. Just so everyone knows, Gus and I are recording this before Thursday night's game. So we won't be able to sort of dissect the game against San Antonio, but I know, you know, Zion's out and Ingram's still out and a number of things. But just looking at the recent dip and the losing streak and after being in first place in the West and everything else, you asked me on your show Wednesday, are you concerned? And I said no. I think CJ, Brandon Ingram, and Zion have played 8 games together out of, what, 30-plus? I think this team still has a tremendous amount of depth, but I think they're still learning how to play with one another. I do. I think they're still figuring things out. But if they figure out defense, and I know their defense is, I don't know, ranked 6th or 7th right now. Efficiency, it was 3rd before the losing streak. But I think their defense has a good bit of improving to do, but I think they're still figuring that part out of it. Good defense leads to the easier offense. When their defense is off, everything is a little more difficult on offense. But they have so many capable guys on offense. I know a lot of people focus on, well, when they have a wall on Zion and guys got to hit the threes and all that stuff, you get B.I. back. I think a lot of things will settle there, Gus. And you know, it wasn't like they didn't score a lot of points against Milwaukee.
It's going to come. This is my – I've been like this since the beginning of the season about this team. You know, Zi'Yon got hurt in the second game. Oh, God, are you freaking out, Scott? I'm like, no, I'm telling you, this year it's different. This team is good. They're going to be fine. And it's a long season. There's a lot of parity in the West. But this team is deep, man. And that's my way of leading into my question to you. You asked that question to me. I know you asked that question to your listeners this week. As the host of the pregame, halftime, and postgame show on the Pelicans Radio Network, I know you think about that. Are you worried about the recent dip? What is your, I guess, as we head into Christmas, what direction is the arrow pointing right now for this Pelicans team?
Well, I mean, I still think it's not pointing, you know, at the 12 o'clock. I mean, because you're losing games. So, but I wouldn't say it's at 6, right? I mean, it's somewhere between 4 and 3. And Willie Green said it after practice on Wednesday about perspective and looking at it, and he's absolutely right. You would have started the season saying only 10 games would have been played with C.J., Brandon, and Zi'Yon on the floor together, and you're above 500, much less have held the top spot in the Western Conference in December, I'd ask you how much you're drinking. I mean, that just doesn't make any sense. So you add to that, Scott, in this train of perspective that Willie Green is leading here, Herb Jones has not looked like Herb Jones from last year. He has not had the kind of season that I think a lot of us expected, whether it's missing time because of injury. He's being officiated like he's never played basketball before. His offense, he's not on the court. I mean, he's had so many games where he picks up his third personal foul in the second quarter.
And he's still a great defender. Willie Green had to use a challenge early in a game because of how they were officiating him. He's an all-defense caliber player, and he's not getting the benefit of that, unfortunately.
So you add that. You add C.J. McCollum had an unbelievably slow start to the season, and he still is inconsistent. Look, it just is what it is. He had 29 points against Phoenix, 27 in the first half, though. And he had 24. He finished at 27. So he had 3 points in the second half. I mean, your max players have got to score more than 3 points in the second half when it's crunch time in the fourth quarter. And that's why you blew a 24-point lead at Phoenix. So I'm not panicking because I can pinpoint, Scott, is what I say in our post game, specifically to why they lost. Okay, the first game at Utah, you just came off two games against the Suns where you essentially mentally and physically thought it was a playoff game. I mean, you just did. So you weren't ready. And Zi'Yon, again, gets 3 fouls in the first half. And at the 9-minute mark of the second quarter, he's whistled for his third personal foul. Changed the game. Completely changed the game. And in that other game, you blew a 15-point lead. In that Thursday game, a game you should have won. The Phoenix game, 24-point lead. A game you should have won. So in those games, though, 4 points or an overtime loss in Utah, you couldn't get to the free throw line, or the other team had more attempts than you as a team. You know, Devin Booker did it. Giannis almost did it by having 22 free throw attempts to your 24. It matters. And those are the reasons you lost, though, right? Offensive rebounding, turnovers, which in that overtime game and that Thursday against Utah, C.J. McCollum's 2 turnovers in the first 3 possessions. I mean, just bad passing, bad decision-making, jumping out of bounds, falling backwards, throwing it to a Jazz player. I mean, you can't have that. So that's certainly different than, Scott, they don't have the horses. Scott, they don't have 3-point shooting.
Yep.
Scott, they don't have depth. Scott, right. They don't have a bench. Scott,
right.
A starter doesn't start. I mean, I can look at it and write it on a sheet of paper, why, And I think finally, too, is Brandon Ingram being out, man, what looks like to be now a month. I mean, he's been out 24, 25 days.
It's been bad. It's to me, so I mentioned about not being worried. I kind of lied. There's one thing that I am very concerned about, and that's that injury. Because it's, they said he had a setback, but you know, all the tests are still fine. You know, it's nothing major, but he's going to miss more time. And then we're going to reevaluate in a week. He's going to miss at least the next two games. That is the thing to me. When people ask me if I'm concerned about the team, you know, because they lost a couple of games in a row, no. The thing I'm concerned about is Brandon Ingram's toe. And they need him back. He needs to get back. And you know, CJ, Zi'Yon, and Brandon only haven't played eight games together. We've talked about it. You need those three guys with JV, you know, with Herb, and then with the bench the way it needs to be, guys coming off of the bench. You need those reps because, you know, a team can find a rhythm, a really good rhythm, when a player or two are out. When they come back, their ceiling might be higher, but they're not as high because they have to find that rhythm again, a new kind of rhythm. And so that was the thing we talked about early in the season, right? The good thing is that they have so much depth, they've been able to still win a good bit of games. But, you know, ultimately, if this team is going to go as far as they can go this season, you need your two best players playing together. And that's Zi'Yon Williamson and Brandon Ingram. And that's, to me, Brandon Ingram's toe. That's my biggest concern right now as we head into Christmas.
Yeah, no question. And I think the other thing that you think about, too, is why I keep saying it's taxing. It's taxing your strength. And your strength on this team that I think separates them from other teams in the Western Conference is their bench and their depth. The problem is you've gone from, hey, you know what's nice? On any given night, Najee, Jose, Trey can give you 15 to 20. On any given night, any of those guys can knock down 3 to 5 threes. Hey, you know what's nice? To be able to have Jayden Daniels get a pair of three-pointers with the fin. Come in. Problem is now you need them. And it's gone from being nice to needing reserve and bench players to play starter minutes or produce like you would want all-star caliber players to do. I mean, and that's the difference. They can do it for a game. They can do it for two. You saw Jose Alvarado lead the way against the Denver Nuggets, right, with all those three-pointers. That's great. But is Jose going to give you 7 three-pointers a game?
No.
So he goes from 30-plus points to he was 0-for-6 against the Bucks. So that's what I'm saying is that as you play better teams, it becomes taxing. And again, that's the other thing you have to think about in these losses. You played a championship-caliber team in Milwaukee. You played a team in the Phoenix Suns that played in the finals. I mean, and you could have won. You could have won in that Suns game. The Bucks are a different level. But how many teams have Giannis and Brooke Lopez?
And Drew Holiday, who's one of the best defenders in the world. Giannis, who's, you know, one of the best players in the world. And Brooke Lopez, who's a great, you know, not only on offense does he stretch with the three-pointer, but he's one of the best rim protectors in the world. So, yeah, most teams can't do what Milwaukee did. You know, they can't. No, they don't have the horses for it.
And, Scott, and earlier in the week, you know, I know they played on Monday, so the week before, I mean, Memphis drummed them by 30. Look, it's just the NBA this year, we've talked about it 100 times. It doesn't matter. Look, the team they're playing Friday, OKC, is I mean, SGA can drop 35, 40 on you out of that. He's going to go to the free throw line. And they're playing in front of sellout crowds. And they're nowhere near 500. So, but they're exciting.
They compete. Everybody in the West competes. Oh. There isn't an easy night in the West. And yes, you know, New Orleans and Memphis are better than Houston. I get it. But there's just, when you look top to bottom, I mean, the Lakers aren't good this year, and yet you know how, you know, I mean, they got LeBron James. Like, it's still, you try to go beat him in L.A., it's a tall task. So there's no gimmies in the West, man. And, you know, on that note, we got to let you run. I know you're busy. I hope you have a very Merry Christmas. My final question for you If Gus Kattengell could have, you know,
how are you?
If you could have whatever you wanted for Christmas, what would it be, Gus?
Thank you.
Merry Christmas to you too.
Look at him. Are you out delivering presents, Santa Claus? That was nice.
No, I. Yeah, well,
how about that?
No, but I would say if I. Oh man. Just anything, like realistic, or
let's be. I don't know. Have fun with it. I will put no.
My initial thought
limit
was I'd love to see another Cubs championship, to where like Carver could be a part of it. But the fact that literally your team is trying to buy every single player and has spent $802 million this offseason.
Mm-hmm.
I could care less now about Major League Baseball.
The luxury tax for the Mets are going to be more than most of the rosters for most of the teams.
It's unbelievable. I mean, so you know what? Thank you. You've taken my interest out of baseball. So what about a run to the NBA Finals?
How about winning it all?
And when I say a run, meaning maybe the Western Conference Finals, that would be fun. Like, just to see what the city would be like.
The whole thing.
The atmosphere. Just, it'd be fun to do that. I mean, quite honestly, I think I don't know if I could stomach it, but I would love to see Memphis in a 7-game, because they're very similar, Scott, and they're both feisty.
Everyone's talking about Pelicans-Suns rivalry, and they're not wrong.
No.
If the Pelicans and Grizzlies played in a playoff series, the animosity, the proximity of the cities, the fan bases, all of it, it would be, I mean, this is an old term from like 10 years ago the youth was using, but it would be lit, dude. It would be that. It would be intense. Well, it would be intense.
Ja Morant and Bane, they don't give a bleep. Like, they will tell you that. They play like that. I remember when they hosted, you know, the Pels the last time. We couldn't talk to Todd in between breaks or even in pregame. Like, as he brought it out, it is the best sound system in the NBA, and it is like a concert in there. And it's intimidating. They play that way. Ja this week said he doesn't fear anybody in the West. And then to your point, you're adding the number one and number two picks in the draft. I mean, that would be my gift. Like, I would love to see that, because I think that's theater. I think that's great storyline. It'd be incredible sports talk show. I mean, that'd be fun, man. That really would be cool, because we're not, I mean,
sign me up.
The Cubs aren't winning anything.
Sign me up for that, man. Sign me up for that. Gus, man, Merry Christmas, brother. I appreciate you, as always, taking the time. I hope you enjoyed those cracklins I sent you last week. How long did they last, by the way?
Truthfully, 36 hours, maybe, about day and a half.
All right. Well, you did better. There's been times where you went a little too hard
I had a Pels game, right? I had a Pels game after I got it, so I brought it. And I noticed I eat a lot more doing the dance. Just sitting there because I'm around. So I didn't stop. That's the problem. You can't just start. You know, I mean, like, when do you even stop? 2, 3, 5, 10?
I just have one or two, and then I stop, to be honest. Maybe 3.
That's impossible.
No.
How do you have one or two? How is that even possible?
I got to watch out for my health, brother. I got you. I mean, even if I wasn't a diabetic, I mean, I love them, but like, I got to watch out for my health, dude.
Oh, man. Well, God, that's why I go to the gym every day.
Stay well. Yeah, dude. There you go. You work out so that you can eat.
Merry Christmas.
Hey, man, all the best, brother. That is Gus Kattengell, our Saints and Pelicans correspondent. We're going to take a timeout. 8 o'clock hour coming up. We're going to talk to Louisiana Raging Cajun running back, All-American kick returner Chris Smith, quarterback Chandler Fields, defensive tackle Zi'Yon Hill-Green, Cody Junot, the sideline reporter, will join me. It's a Gimme All You Got Friday on the Great Scott Show. Don't go anywhere. 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420 The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.
Welcome back into the Great Scott Show. On a Friday, December 23rd, Give me all you got Friday, bowl game day, Louisiana taking on Houston at 2 o'clock today in the Independence Bowl in Shreveport. And now it's time to welcome on a guy that will be taking part in that game, playing in that game. Running back Chris Smith of Louisiana's Raging Cajuns steps on the phone line now here on the Great Scott Show, 103.3 The Goat simulcast on 1420. Chris, your last game as a Raging Cajun today, has that sunk in yet?
Man, it's sunk in, man. It's been a great opportunity. Yesterday I sat down in our practice and just thought about, like, this is my last one with this team, and now I'm out here. It's going to be great. This team excited. It's going to be a great day.
You know, what went into your decision to head to the NFL draft after this season? Was it a no-brainer? Was it one you prayed a lot about? Take us into your mindset.
Last season, I thought about coming out. I feel like there's more I need to put on the table to see. But as more as it got closer, and I thought about it, prayed about it, I talked to the scout. They told me it's not about the stats you put out. It's not about how well you do every game. Like what you do with the ball, when you have it, what you do as a teammate, and what are you going to bring to the table for their team and for the next level. For me, and I thought about that, it's like they know what I can do. They know I can return the ball. They know I can run the ball well. They just want to see what I can do once I get to that next level. So as the opportunity got closer, I made my decision. I think it's going to be a great one I've made in my life.
What about your decision to play in this game? Some players, you know, they say I'm going to declare for the NFL draft, thus ending, you know, the rest of my eligibility, and I'm going to opt out of this bowl game. And Coach Desimo said, as far as you go, he told me you went into his office and you're like, I'm just letting you know my decision, and I'm also letting you know I am playing no matter what. So what went into that decision, and why were you so adamant about it?
Yeah, I'm all in with this team. When I signed in 2018, I was like, I'm all in no matter what. Like, it's ups and downs, it doesn't matter. Like, this season, a lot of players could have been opt out with the season we've had this year because it hasn't been the best season that we've had, but I'm all in. Like, no matter what happens with this team, UL, Raiders, Cajun, they'll all be a special part in my life. And, like, when I decide to play, like, I know I want to go out there and finish this. We didn't get the Sun Belt Championship, but we can go out there and get this bowl, Independence Bowl Championship today.
Chris Smith, our guest, Louisiana Raging Cajun running back, All-American kick returner. Looking back at your career, I know you got one left today, Chris, but as of right now, what's your favorite memory? What's the one you think will be everlasting for you from your time at UL?
Winning the first Sun Belt Conference Championship last year. That will always be a great moment. Just not the individual accomplishments that they had, but the accomplishment that the team had last year. It was a great experience. It's one that we wanted to repeat this year, but didn't get the chance. But I'll forever and always remember winning that championship, because coming out of high school, you know, I went to the South State Championship that we have every year. In my senior year, I went to the state championship and lost. But when I finally got to college, and we've been to four, almost five, and you win two, it's a great experience, and I always remember both of those.
Man, I remember being in the where they were holding the post-game press conferences last year after that one, which is not where they typically hold them after a game, but because it was a conference championship, it was in y'all's meeting room. And, you know, at one point, I guess, you know, Billy opened the door. Someone opened the door to go in. And I just saw you outside the door, like, you still had the pads on. You had a big sign that said championship. I think you were dancing. I mean, it doesn't surprise me that you mentioned that as your favorite memory, man, because you were so excited. You didn't want to take your pads off, but you were still just basking in the glory of it, man.
I was very excited. Like, I didn't even get to play much of that championship game, but just being a part of it, like, knowing that I helped get this team here, this team played very well to get that championship game. It was a great experience. Like I said, it will always be one of the best experiences that I've had at the university.
Chris Smith, our guest. How are you feeling right now physically heading into this one today, Chris?
Oh, I feel great. We've had a couple weeks off, a couple days off. Practice has been hard, but you know, Coach Dez, he's going to take care of us. And I feel good. A lot of the guys feel good. They're back healthy. It's going to be a great game.
What's it been like to play for Coach Desimo as the head coach this season?
I would say it's been great. Like I said before, he's taken care of us. He's more of a the players are going to lead this team type of guy, and we've done that the best of our can. Like, just building a bond with every player on the team, even the freshmen that have come in, even the walk-ons that have come in. Everybody feel that they have an important role in this team, and just keeping that going. Like, a lot of places we go and say, this team's one of the best they've hosted. And it's not just because what the coach did has taught us. It's about what the leadership has taught the young guys, and they're going to continue to bring it each and every year.
What if you could use one word that you think best describes Coach Desimo, what would that word be?
One word. That's tough because Coach Des, he's a lot of great things. But to sum it up, he's a man. He's a real man. Not just on the field but off the field. He keeps his word. He's a great husband to his kids. His kids love me. His wife, they're a great family. But when he comes to the football field, it's the same energy. He treats everyone like we're his kids. So a man or either a father for this team is a great word for that.
There you go. Good stuff. Chris Smith, our guest. All right, Chris, if you had your preference, okay, kick return for a touchdown or let's say a 70-plus yard touchdown on offense, whether it be a run or a catch, which one are you picking?
Man, I would rather try to get a 70-yard passing touchdown, but I don't want to mess my little one-for-one ratio that I have right now. So I guess I'm going to just keep the kick. I'll do the kick return because I ain't had one in a long time.
Yeah, no doubt, man. Speaking of, impacts, what kind of impact do you think the weather's going to have on today's matchup, man? It's going to be cold out there.
Oh, it's going to be a little chilly, but a lot of guys are prepared. We always say, the weather is our advantage. So we're prepared for each and every. It don't matter if it's 120 degrees outside. We're going to find a way to be prepared for it.
What in your mind are the keys to victory today, Chris?
Oh, run the ball at will and throw the ball at will. If we can do that, nobody can stop us. We just got to go out there and do the tangibles, do what you got to do. Do your 111, that's what we say.
Yeah.
And just go out there and handle business. Everybody do their job. We'll be fine.
What's the bowl experience been like this week for you guys?
Oh, a lot of guys that haven't experienced, like the freshmen, a lot of walk-ons that haven't experienced, can come out here and just see how the older guys do, see how we go out and have fun, and not just in your room all day while here competing in everything that we do, even if it's playing ping pong or arcade games in the player lounge. So really just continue to build our bond that we've created and make sure nobody's left out.
Man, I saw some photos and video of you guys working with the Holy Angels. That's a center and a home for those that have special needs and special mental needs. And, seeing the energy you guys put into that and their reaction, man, I mean, moments like that, they're special. And that's using your platform. But the fact that you guys took the time to do that, man, describe that experience for us.
One second.
Lord. Let the man clear his throat. Tell Evan to get you some water. Come on, Evan.
Ooh, excuse me.
It's all good. Tell Evan to bring you some water, man. What's he doing? Tell him to get you some water. Come on.
I don't know what Evan got going on.
All right.
But it was a great experience. We made cookies. We were coloring pictures. Everything. Like, at the end of the day, this is not just for us, but it's for the community that we're in. It's for the community of Lafayette.
All right. Looks like Evan finally got you some water. I've only got a few more questions for you, man. But you were talking about, that impact and getting to work with that. Here are my last two questions, Chris. This one, this is an important one. All right. So just, I'm sure you have a strong opinion of it. You worked in off seasons at Baskin Robbins. What is the best flavor of ice cream? I mean, because you've got some experience here. You've dabbled in this. What your opinion carries a little more weight here. What's the best flavor of ice cream?
See, I'm a chocolate kind of guy. So that we got the Dutch chocolate, we got the regular chocolate, but we also got the Snickers and Reese's.
Now those are good.
You can't go wrong with either one of those.
All right.
But they also have a flavor of the month. Each month, I would advise trying those out, too.
Yeah. I mean, the man knows ice cream like he knows football. All right, last question, Chris, because I don't want you to cough anymore.
What would be the perfect way for Chris Smith to cap off his college career today?
Oh, go out here and win this game. That's all we got to do. Go out there and get us one last ring with this team, and I'll be perfectly fine with that.
Chris, man, it's been awesome getting to interview you over the years, and you know, you've always been great to the media. You've been a great teammate, man. All the best on your next journey after today, and we look forward to maybe talking to you again sometime in the future, and we can look back at your time with the Cajuns and what life's bringing your way here in the coming years.
Yes, sir. Sounds good. Appreciate you for having me today.
You got it. That is Chris Smith, Louisiana Raging Cajun running back and kick returner here on The Great Scott Show. Stay tuned. We're going to take a quick timeout here on 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420. And when we come back, we got some more. Quarterback Chandler Fields, defensive tackle Zi'Yon Hill-Green, they're coming your way. It's The Great Scott Show on a Gimme All You Got. Welcome back into The Great Scott Show on a Gimme All You Got Friday. Good morning. It is Bowl Day. Independence Bowl today in Shreveport, Louisiana, taking on Houston. We just talked to running back Chris Smith in the last segment. We're going to talk to Zi'Yon Hill-Green in a few minutes. But right now, a guy I talked to just before the season and last day of the season, quarterback Chandler Fields, comes on The Great Scott Show here on 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420. Good morning, Chandler, man. How you feeling about the game today and just the fact that you get to play football today, man?
Good morning, Scott. We're really excited for today and can't wait for this opportunity ahead of us.
All right, so folks listening might not get the question at first, but did you see the play at the end of that Raiders-Patriots game last week in the NFL?
I did.
So did you think of me because Chandler Jones scored a touchdown, and did you say, man, I remember when Scott called me Chandler Jones in an interview?
I actually do remember that, and maybe it's destined that we'll score one today just because that happened.
Good, good. Chandler Fields is our guest. Look, man, this season for you, you know, it's you were the starter, then you were hurt, then you were back, then the low point and the high point of this season. I want to go through those two briefly before we focus on today's game. Just for you personally, Chandler, what was the toughest part? What was the low point for you?
I think the lowest point of the season was just not being able to play with my teammates and having to accept the role as a backup for a couple weeks and just being there mentally and physically. When I couldn't be there physically, being there mentally made me grow as a person. I think I grew from my experience, and I'm happy for all my struggles this season.
What was the high point of the season for you up to this point?
I think the high point for the season was getting that win at Texas State and earning another game to play today.
Yeah, man, that win has allowed you guys to have a lot more time together, to experience this week together. What's the bowl week experience been like in Shreveport?
Oh, it's been awesome. We spend a lot of time together. We get to go to the casino at night if you're 21, you know, and play some craps, play a little roulette, and just chill with the guys, have some great food, and have a great time out here.
Really? So how did you do on the roulette table? Be honest.
I came up, you know, some teammates lost some money, but I opted out at the right time.
There you go. See, you know, the man, you got it. Like Kenny Rogers says, man, you got to know when to hold them and when to fold them. I don't know if I've ever referenced Kenny Rogers on the show before, but you know, that's a first with Chandler Fields. How are you feeling physically right now, man? Where are you at?
I feel great. We had a great, I'd say almost a month off. So I think everybody on the team is feeling real, really great for the team, and I'm feeling good as well.
Is that like, do you, all things considered generally, is the most healthy you feel generally, if you're a bowl team, is it usually the first and last game of the season when you're feeling best?
I would think so. And I think being the last game, you can leave everything out there on the field. I think coach is going to call some great plays, and everybody's healthy to give us a great game this Friday.
How are you preparing for the cold of this one today, man? Because the feels like temperature, you know, with the wind chill and everything else, going to be, you know, like one or zero. And look, I know you, man. You grew up in Metairie. You know, we're from South Louisiana. I mean, that's some cold weather for us. So how are you preparing for that?
Well, Ethan, our equipment manager, has hand warmers ready. He has, you know, little hand heaters, whatever you call those. He has heated benches for us. He has beanies for the sideline and all kind of thermal wear. So hopefully it all works out well. I mean, I've personally never played in zero-degree weather, so should be fun.
Yeah, here we go. I don't know that too many players on Houston have either. What has stood out to you about the Houston Cougars as you're preparing for this matchup?
I think their D-line is a pretty good group. I think they're pretty talented across the board. Their corners are good as well, and their safeties. I think they're good all around. I just think we need to play our game and just go out there and execute.
Louisiana Raging Cajun quarterback Chandler Fields, our guest here, 103.3 The Goat simulcast on 1420. Pregame begins today at noon, kickoff at 2. You can hear it right here. So Michael Jefferson he's not playing in this one. I know Dante Fleming transferred to Tulane, but the depth at wide receiver, you and I talked about it before the season. Do you feel like all the depth and experience you have there, maybe – you know, typically you lose a guy like a Jefferson and a Fleming, it's going to be a loss. But for your roster, maybe not as big a loss as it typically would be other places, just because of all the experience there.
I mean, you hate to lose those two guys. They're great players, great people. But I think we have a great room in there, and we have a bunch of people that are ready to step up and that are eager to play a big part in this game. So we're excited.
You guys got to do some community work with the Holy Angels this week, you know, a center for those with special needs. And seeing the looks on their faces and the energy y'all put into it and that kid dunking the ball, man, those are moments that are just a reminder that, you know, some things are bigger than sports, right?
Oh, for sure. Actually, I think I said the casino was the highlight of the week, but actually I think spending time with those kids was probably the highlight of the week. Those kids not only impacted us, but we got to impact them, and it was just awesome just to see their smiles, and they made us definitely smile as we got to interact with them.
Hey, man, what's wrong with our Saints this season? What's going on?
I don't know, man. I hope Tampa Bay loses out and we can win 3 more games and get in there, but I'm not sure what's going on.
I love the optimism. I do. Yeah, it's and I know you don't sound optimistic, but God bless you. You and I know plenty of Saints fans that think that they could somehow still pull off the miracle. Unfortunately, I don't think it's going to happen. But
it's really not going to happen.
Yeah, but you know, come on. Until they're mathematically eliminated, there's always going to be that real small part of you that's like, you know what? You're saying there's a chance. You know what I mean?
100%.
Hey, man, what's your favorite Christmas movie?
Elf, without a doubt.
See, I knew you were going to. I think you told me that was your actual favorite movie before the season.
It is. So, I'll watch it any time of the year, and I'll get a good laugh.
I knew you were going to say Elf. All right, let's get back to football, and then we'll let you run, Chandler. In your mind, what's the biggest key for you guys offensively today in this matchup and ending the season with the win?
Establishing a line of scrimmage up front with our O-line and their D-line. And I think taking what they give us at quarterback and making big explosive runs and just playing our brand of football, and we'll be all right.
Hey, man, Merry Christmas. Good luck today. And I'm sure I'll see you at the gym sometime in the next month or two. But all the best, man. I appreciate you taking the time as always. And we'll talk to you again in the future, all right?
Yes, sir. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. That is Chandler Fields, not Chandler Jones, Chandler Fields, Louisiana Raging Cajun quarterback. The Cajuns take it on the Houston Cougars today. Noon pregame show right here, and then at 2 o'clock kickoff if you want to catch it on the radio for those of you that aren't making the trip. Zi'Yon Hill-Green, Louisiana Raging Cajun defensive tackle, going to join us now. So Zi'Yon Hill-Green, we've got him now. Zi'Yon, man, I was thinking to myself, I'm like, I feel like I've talked to Zi'Yon for like years, and I was like, well, yeah, I have. I mean, you know, you've had a long career, right? 3 head coaches, yeah, bowl wins, bowl losses, conference championship, a coach fired, a coach hired, a coach departing for another. I mean, you've experienced a lot in your career that most players have never really deal with any of it. How would you describe the ride at UL up to this point for you?
You know, I would say the journey is, it's something people take for granted. You know, I'm blessed that God put me on this journey, because I wouldn't have met the coaches or the teammates or the people I've met, you know, on this journey and sticking around. It's been a roller coaster, you know, and in life you're going to have ups and downs, you know, but it's it's how you respond to things, I would say. So I would say I had a good response to all of it, you know. Some of it affected me more than others, but I would say it's been a roller coaster, no, but a fun roller coaster, a roller coaster that I wouldn't change. I don't regret, you know, I wouldn't go back and change anything. I enjoyed it.
All right. I asked a man to describe the ride, and he says roller coaster. You're pretty good at this media thing, Zi'Yon, but I feel like you've always kind of been yourself too, which, you know, part of that is, you know, you wear your emotions on your sleeve and, you know, you seem to be a pretty happy guy, but you described it. There were some tough times along the way. Has it sunk in yet, like, that today is your last game in a Raging Cajun uniform?
It's funny because I was just talking to Chris Smith about it, you know. It's been a long one, a long 6 years. You know, I've seen seniors come and go, but I never thought, you know, my time would come. I never thought it would be me. It would be me that would be in this predicament, you know, worrying about my last game. But I'm ready to go out there and give it my all, you know, and have fun. You know, I probably will tear up a little bit, you know, after the game. You know, because the college atmosphere, you can't get that nowhere else. College football, it's nothing like college football. So I'll miss but the thing I miss the most is my teammates, you know, the family I made playing in these 6 years of football, you know. But I feel like it's going to sink in. As soon as the clock is zero, I feel like it's all going to sink in.
Yeah, man, a lot leading up to this. And hearing you describe your passion for it, I guess it's not a surprise that, you know, you announced that your intention to declare for the NFL draft, but you ended it. You were adamant about playing in this game. And I would ask you why, but I think you just kind of answered that before I even asked you the question, right?
Yes, sir.
This record... Yeah, I'm sorry. Go ahead. No, you're gonna go on it more. So if you could expound on it, maybe just a little bit more. Why were you so adamant about playing in this game?
You know, I've always been a guy that quitting is just not an option. You know, I feel like I owe Raging Cajun Nation. You know, I feel like I owe them the world. You know, they took a chance on a small, undersized D lineman. You know, from right down the street, and I feel like I owe them that. You know, they supported me. With amazing support, you know, the most support I'll probably say I got in my life, you know. But my biggest fan is my biggest fans are kids that run up to me and hug me like I've known them my whole life, you know. But they're fans, you know. But also I appreciate them for that. That would motivate me to go, you know. And I feel like giving up and just opting out of the bowl game would have hurt a lot of people, you know. They would have thought of me different. They would have looked at me different, you know. But I wanted them to know that the love I have is genuine, you know, it's real genuine. So I decided to finish up the season with my teammates and with my coaches.
You have an opportunity to sit atop the career sack record for Louisiana. You're tied right now with Christian Ringo and Jeff Mitchell. How tired are you hearing about this? Because you've probably been asked about this record, you know, more than the actual bowl game.
You know, a lot of people, Coach Morgan, defensive coordinator, you know, yeah. He messes with me a lot. He was like, are you going to go get that charity sack? You know, they're going to give you a 0.5. I'm going to tell them to write you up a 0.5. You know, but, you know, it's a great thing. You know, it's a great thing to look forward to. But also I had to realize, you know, you have to just play your game. You have to let the sack come natural. You know, the minute you're thinking about it and trying to force it, you know, you're going to mess up. So, but that's also a big thing for me. You know, your name is in the record books. That is something that lives on forever. You know, and the last sack I got, you know, I got a good celebration lined up for it. So, you know, I hope people are ready.
I'll be ready. I mean, go get it, man. I'll be ready. This bowl experience this week, I know you've experienced a few different bowls. How's this one been for you?
You know, it's not bad. I'm enjoying it. You know, enjoying time with my teammates. You know, we've been in the casino a little bit, you know, enjoying ourselves. But I've been spending quality time with my teammates, you know, because it's probably the last time we're going to all be together. You know, some of my guys that are also 6 year seniors, you know, we've been here forever. And after this week, I won't see them ever again, you know. So I'm soaking all that in, enjoying my quality time. But the bowl game, I would say, you know, the surrounding area, it's cool. I've never been to Shreveport, you know. Also, even though I'm from Louisiana, I've never been to Shreveport, you know, right down the street. But it's fun seeing something different, you know, something different than what you used to have. So I'm soaking it all up.
Yeah, now you get the whole joke that we make in South Louisiana about how North Louisiana is more like, you know, Central Arkansas or East Texas.
Yes.
You get it now.
Yes.
It's the same state, but it's like two different states. It's very different.
Yes, sir.
All right, last thing on today's game, Zi'Yon. Two-part question. One, what kind of impact do you think weather will make? And two, what do you feel are the keys to the game today for you guys to procure the victory?
You know, we've played in worse. You know, we played in worse App State 2020. You know, we've played in worse weather conditions. So I feel like the weather won't be a factor. You know, I feel like we're going to be excited to play, you know, because once you start moving around the weather, you forget completely about the weather, you know. And I would say the factors to winning the game, you know, is running to the ball on defense. That is every defense key aspect in every game, you know, and also doing the little things right, you know, techniques such as finishing plays when it needs to be finished, you know, punching in the touchdown when we need to punch in the touchdown, and everyone being on the same page, you know, doing our 111 on defense, everyone doing their job, and, you know, being the more excited team to play.
Zi'Yon Hill-Green has been our guest. Man, it's been a pleasure getting to interview you off and on here over the last number of years. Best of luck after today on the next step, but I appreciate you always taking the time, man, and it's been fun covering you, and good luck today. Merry Christmas, and I'm sure we'll talk to you again in the future, my friend.
Yes, sir. Always. Thank you. I appreciate you.
You got it. That is Zi'Yon Hill-Green. Appreciate him and Chandler Fields and Chris Smith for coming on this morning. It's Independence Bowl today, noon pregame, 2 o'clock kickoff. You can hear it on 103.3 The GOAT on 1420. You can hear it on Hot 107.9. Because of Independence Bowl media rights, we are not able to stream the game today via our stream, but you can certainly listen to it terrestrially. And if you're watching on TV, we invite you to turn down the volume on the TV, sync it up with the radio, make it happen. You can stream the game via the UL website if you need to do that for audio purposes. But it's bowl game, baby. Independence Bowl. It's a Gimme All You Got Friday. A lot to get into. It's the Great Scott Show. 103.3 The GOAT simulcast on 1420. And one of the individuals who will be on the broadcast today, the radio broadcast, sideline reporter Cody Junot. Just how much is he, you know, how many layers is he going to have to wear for this game? I mean, Cody's not exactly, you know, I mean, look, I love Cody. He's my friend. I wouldn't say he's somebody that's worried about, like, how he looks on the sideline. He's not, you know, he's not watching Making the Cut with, you know, Heidi Klum and whatever that fellow's name is, Tim Gunn. Is that it? I think I got it. Wow. My wife would be proud. No, my point is, you know, it's not so much about the fashion. It's about just being warm. We'll have some fun with Cody. But what we're going to talk about today's matchup and this season for the Cajuns and kind of what's led up to it. And Cody joins me next right here on 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420. It's The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time. This is The Great Scott Show. Don't go anywhere. At Friday, don't go anywhere. Welcome back into the Great Scott Show on a Gimme All You Got Friday. It is Bowl Day. Independence Bowl. We just spoke with Chris Smith, with Chandler Fields, with Zi'Yon Hill-Green, and now the guy that's going to try to just trump all of them is the man who will be on the broadcast today with Jay Walker and Gerald Broussard, Cody Junot, sideline reporter for Louisiana's Raging Cajuns. My friend, good morning, Cody. How you feeling, man? Merry Christmas.
Yeah, Merry Christmas, Scott. I am just mentally trying to prepare for whatever today brings us. And we're strictly talking about the weather. All those guys got a game to play. I'm just trying to figure out how to stay warm.
You know, I asked the players about it. They're like, it's, you know, well, they all gave kind of different answers. Chris Smith's like, we'll be fine. Chandler Fields, I asked him how they prepare for it. He's like, you know, we got hand warmers and other stuff. It'll be all right. And Zion's like, I played in a colder game in Boone. And those are football answers, okay? You're on the sideline. I mean, how many layers are you going to be wearing today, dude?
I guarantee y'all probably look like the Michelin Man. So I think we've got at least three pair of pants, or two pairs of pants. We've got some nice leggings, good socks, gloves, hoodie, raincoat, another coat, and four coats total if needed. I don't know that we'll need to go that far, but we packed the whole closet, you know, because you just got to be prepared.
Yeah, thank God y'all are playing in Shreveport and not like in Wyoming, where the wind chill last night in Lusk was negative 70. So it is.
Or where you're dealing with an airplane and you kind of have to pack a little differently, right?
Like, yeah.
You know, the backseat of my truck driving up yesterday was full of clothes and it's fine.
Oh, man. Yeah. Now, speaking of that, though, I mean, being able to play in the Independence Bowl for the first time, being that it's driving distance, being that it's against Houston, I said this, you know, when the season ended. I obviously, the season did not live up to the expectations that both the fan base and the team put on themselves. But if they had finished, you know, 8-4, 9-3, I still feel like of the realistic bowl options, this was probably the best one just based on location and opponent and things like that.
Well, no, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, the fact that, you know, you get to your point, you get to play somewhere different, and you get a really, you know, historic type bowl game, quality bowl game. You're getting to play against an American opponent who's leaving for the Big 12, right? So you can hang your hat on a couple of those things. And it, you know, it should be a good matchup between two, you know, air quote, local teams in Houston and Louisiana. I do think that the weather is going to impact the crowd a little bit. You know, kind of been joking this week, it's death taxes and bad weather for the Independence Bowl. Just things that always seem to kind of happen. But no, I mean, and I think, you know, the team's going to be excited to take the field here this afternoon.
Cody Junot, our guest, he's excited too. Just don't let him fool you otherwise. I mentioned this season not quite living up to the expectation. It's been a season of swings, some ups and downs. What in your mind was the low point and the high point of the season at this point?
Yeah, so I mean, I think a couple of things. Obviously, you go, you know, I think the low point is the Monroe game and how that turned out. I think the Rice game, despite the fact that with what 6-7 minutes to go, you got the opportunity to win that contest, the Cajuns just played their worst game of the year, right? They played bad from start to finish. And then you go to Monroe the next week and you get off to the really good start, and then all of a sudden things spiral, and that spiral continued. And I know there were, you know, a couple wins in between there, but, you know, I feel like that Monroe loss led to the South Owl loss, and then, you know, a couple of weeks later when you're dealing with the Southern Miss, and you just very uncharacteristic things of turning the football over, a lot of bad penalties and bad times. You know, and then that Troy game, right, where Cajuns, you know, get shut out in the second half, and you could feel it down there on the sideline, Scott, saying, oh, crap, here we go again. You know, and so I think, you know, there were certainly plenty of ups and downs, but the one thing that this team that happened, and Des and I talked about it, you know, close game at Texas State, was they never quit. There was never an ounce of doubt you know, that they were going to stick together and finish and play through, you know. And so I think, again, 6-6, you know, hindsight is always 20-20. But given the fact that you had five offensive linemen who started who didn't play a single snap in spring, right? You lost a guy that was drafted in the fourth round by the New York Jets. You lost another guy in Shane Ballou, a three-year center, a six-year player, seven-year player in Ken Marks. And then, oh, by the way, you know, Osiris Torrance, who left from Florida, is going to be a first-round draft pick. And so we kind of just seemingly expected that the next five guys would just step up, and it didn't happen, you know, and that led to kind of a slow start. So I say all of that, right, that's kind of the downside, but the one big positive for me is I saw team never quit, one, and two, Michael Desimo got better in head coaching things, in my opinion, as the season went along. And I think that's going to be a springboard for the Cajuns moving forward.
Cody Junot, our guest. I think when you look at big picture beyond this season, you know, that's folks are starting to do it. It's something we'll do a lot. And obviously with signing day being Wednesday, everyone's doing it. But because of early signing day, it falls right around bowl time. The same thing happened last year. Granted, there was a lot more happening last year. I mean, you were replacing coaches and everything else. But as far as today's game goes, what are you expecting here? Because I see two teams, Cody, that, you know, are very different in some ways in terms of, I guess, offensive philosophy, a little different, but similar in that they both had big expectations before the season. They were both picked to really compete, at least in their divisions and in their conferences. And, you know, I think both teams would admit to you, have admitted to you, right, Dana Holgorsen and Coach Michael Desimo, that they're happy to be here. They're glad they're playing. They expect to win today. But they would also admit to you that, you know, the season didn't go exactly how they had planned, and you kind of readjusted goals as the season went on, right? Once the conference championship was out of play, then you kind of readjust your goals a little bit. So they're kind of similar in their path to here, but I know both of them really want to end on a winning note. I mean, to finish the season with a winning record, I think it's big, and I think it's big for Coach Des, and I think it's big for UL. And in the grand scheme of things, will we remember the Independence Bowl, you know, the same way that we remember some of the other bowl championships? That depends on what happens today, honestly. I don't want to put too much on it, but I do think this is an important game, Cody. I know sometimes you get to a bowl game and folks are like, well, it's bonus, it's fun, both teams know what's up. No, you want to go out there and win, man. I mean, I people keep asking me, what do you expect to happen? And because it's been so long since their last game, because it's going to be freezing, as we said, and Houston loves to chuck it around, I'm having trouble getting a read on what's going to happen here today. I just know Houston's got a lot of talent, but, you know, what team is going to show up, man? This is one that, you know, I'm not betting on, for the record, but even if I didn't, even if I was just a perpetual gambler, I think I would still stay away from this game today because I just can't get a read on it, dude.
A little bit more than your current degenerate status?
A lot more.
No, I think you're spot on, right? And both these teams kind of went through early season, you know, lulls and kind of ran into some issues that clearly neither was expecting. You're right, Houston was a pick by many, you know, be playing in the game that Tulane's playing in the Cotton Bowl, being in that New Year's Six game. And the thing about bowl games, Scott, is it's a question every year for each and every game outside of the college football playoff, and that's who wants to be there, right? What team really wants to be there? And I know this. I know that the Cajuns, whether it, you know, it's obviously in Shreveport here today, but whether it was in New Orleans or Mobile or, you know, Montgomery, Orlando, wherever, the Cajuns want it to be in a bowl game, right? The Cajuns want to be here. They're going to come out and I think play. What I don't know about Houston is how many of those guys really want to play, right? You know, and I'd say one last thing about the weather that we haven't touched about. It's going to be windy all day long, right? So not only the really cold temperatures, but how's that wind going to affect a prolific passing game, you know, from the Cougars? And so for me, the biggest question always, who wants to play? And look, I think we'll figure that out fairly early because it's not going to be easy given the conditions of what's going to happen today with the weather.
Cody Junot, our guest. What with that, with it, all the unknowns we just said, I mean, ultimately, what do you think a winning box score looks like for the winning team today? I know Houston loves to chuck it around everywhere and throw it, but I mean, I just feel like whatever team runs the ball better, and maybe, look, maybe we're putting too much into the weather. Maybe I am, you know, I don't know. I just, in talking to Gerald this week, you know, and in talking to James Butler, you know, former receiver this week, and hearing them describe trying to catch a football in weather like this, I mean, James is like, you can't really feel the ball, you know, like you when it's in the air, you're like, don't drop it, because he played a game at Troy. He's like, I couldn't feel my hands. You know, you could put gloves on, but it's, look, bottom line is it's harder to sling it. And this Houston's a team that wants to throw it. And the Cajuns, obviously they can throw it, but they're not, they don't lean on the pass as much as Houston. So I think the box score today, if whoever runs the ball effectively, man, is probably going to win this thing.
No, oh, I think you're exactly right. And I think, you know, take that a step further. I think for the Cajuns, right, whether Houston decides to run the football or not, I think if the Cajuns can run the football and play defense with that Louisiana offense, right, keep the Cougars off the field, you know, because it's Houston D's coming in averaging, I don't know what, 34, 35 points a game that they're giving up, right? So they clearly are not the strength of the ball club. So if the Cajuns can come out, establish that running game, matriculate the ball right down the field. That's a good word, matriculate.
Well done. You're so smart.
Have a you know, very conscious drives. You know, eat up a lot of clock and then finish with touchdowns. You know, I think that's going to be the game plan for Louisiana.
-7 officially is the spread for Houston. +7 for the Cajuns. Over under is 56.5. No Michael Jefferson. No Dante Fleming. I talked to Chandler Fields about it earlier. He's like, obviously, you'd prefer to have those guys than to not. But they've had some depth at receiver. You know, they've had a lot of guys waiting. You look at a John Stevens Jr. and some of the other, you know, a Peter LeBlanc, guys that have experience. And on top of that, you know, some of the younger guys, you know, Lance LeJean, you might see some more of him, I think, here today. I don't know if we'll see Zi'Yon Chris. I know that, you know, all the freshmen they wanted to keep red shirts on have all only played 3 games, so they are available. But, you know, yep. Coach Des,
well, and
yeah. Go ahead.
They'll say, and it's, you know, the NCAA actually passed the rule heading into bowl season. If they've got any freshmen and the Cajuns don't, but if they had anybody that was at 4 games, they are actually eligible to play a fifth in a bowl game and not lose that year.
Well, there you go.
Which I thought is a rare good move coming out of Indianapolis.
I didn't even know that, Cody. You just taught me that. I just looked at Zion's, you know, game log, and I was like, oh, we're good. You know, I didn't even know that. I talked to Coach about it a few weeks ago, and maybe I just didn't pick up on it. Either way, you got these guys available. So, you know, the bowl game, when you have some players opting out, and there's not that many. I mean, you had a couple of guys that hit the portal, and, you know, Andre Jones opted out. But for the most part, at least compared to last year, you know, the Cajuns have a good bit of guys available to go today. The one exception, I think, just at receiver, when you look at Jefferson and Fleming and the stats they put up this year. But there's a lot of experience there. And at the same time, in a game like today, I think it might only be, you know, one reception, maybe two receptions. I don't know that you're going to have a receiver for the Cajuns, even if you did have Jefferson, maybe, you know, reel in 6 or 7 in a game like the one today. So I guess my point is, I think the weather, I think player availability, I think a lot of that stuff leans toward the Cajuns, but overall offense and just maybe overall talent in terms of who's playing at the next level, you might have a little bit more of that on Houston, obviously. And now I'm just talking in circles again because I have no idea what's going to happen today.
No, I think you're spot on. You know, and honestly, for me, the loss of Andre Jones, I think, is maybe a little bit bigger cause of concern for Louisiana. Number one, because of how good of a football player he is, right? His size, his speed, his ability to move, you know, laterally down the line of scrimmage and really string things out. But remember, Scott, that's a defensive front that's already very thin because of injuries and other issues, right? Marcus Weiser, you know, hadn't played since, I think, game 3. You know, Lawson's got the knee injury. And so you've got guys that are banged up. You know, Landry's not available for some academic issues. So that's already a very depleted defensive front for the Cajuns. And so that's why, for me, you know, not having Andre Jones in this one is a cause for a little bit of concern.
Cody Junot, our guest, he'll be on the sideline today for the game. Noon pregame, 2 o'clock kickoff in Shreveport. We've been talking bowl here this hour, pretty much this entire hour on the Great Scott Show. It's the Independence Bowl, and Cody and Jay Walker and Gerald have the call, a 13th game and an important one for a lot of reasons we discussed. Appreciate Chandler Fields and Zi'Yon Hill-Green and Chris Smith for coming on. And I guess, Cody, my last question is, you know, what player, if it is in your mind, the X factor today for Louisiana?
Yeah, I mean, based off of everything that we've kind of said, right, it's what running back's going to step up for me for the Cajuns. You know, one, obviously take care of the football, make the plays that you need to make, right? So that's Chandler starting with the quarterback. But for me, right, you know, is it Washington? You know, who's the back that steps up and is really able to kind of, you know, carry some of this, what we think is going to be probably a pretty heavy workload for Louisiana, maybe, you know, pound down that Cougars defense?
I think Chris is as healthy as he's been all season, having, you know, the time off before the bowl game. It's his last one. I think Chris Smith is going to have a big finale for his career today. That's my prediction.
Well, I hope you're right, and I'll add one more thing. Let's see if Eric Garrett can get loose one more time, because that guy's just a special football player out there in that secondary. And the fact that he had not one but two touchdowns called back, you know, in that regular season game, we'll see if he can find his way to pay dirt today as well.
Man, whether it be via defense or special teams, and ultimately, as much as we sort of ramble about what might happen, let's be real. If one of these two teams scores a touchdown in one of the other two phases of the game, they're probably going to win. You know, you get one on special teams or you get one on defense and the other team doesn't, you're probably going to win today's game. Even though, you know, there might be a good bit of points, and Eric Gehr has just been, he's been outstanding, man. And he's played pretty much nonstop since he got to UL, and this is the last one for him. And, you know, he's always going to have that chip on his shoulder, but of all these guys that might, you know, that are on the team that could be playing next year, Eric Gehr is going to be on an NFL roster next season. And he's going to go into camp and he's going to get overlooked and he's going to end up making an NFL roster, because that's just the kind of guy he is and that's just the kind of player he's been.
No, I think you're spot on. And, you know, last thing to add there is it's not just the NFL anymore, right? Between the XFL and the USFL, there's a lot of opportunities for these guys to continue playing football.
Yeah, but after today, they might be like, I'm not sure about the CFL. Is this how the weather is up there? I don't know.
All the time.
I don't know. All right, with that, man, Cody Junot has been our guest. What do the boys want for Christmas this year, man? They're not listening.
You know,
I hope not. Maybe they are.
What's that?
I said they're probably not listening, so we're fine.
Yeah, they're good. They're good. We'll see what Santa comes down the old chimney with.
There you go. He doesn't want to give anything away. My son, I don't know why Callaway kept saying this. Clearly, I do know why. I don't know where he heard it. He had to be watching some show, some kid's show from like 15 years ago. Because for like 3 weeks straight, he's like, I want an iPhone 6 and an Xbox. I'm like, no, you don't.
Oh,
like,
okay.
You don't.
An iPhone 6, though, you're getting away. You know, mine's asking for an iPhone 14. So,
I mean, he clearly just heard it in some show that came out years ago. And it's like, first of all, even if it was, you know, 14 years ago, you're not getting that for Christmas. You're 7, okay? And dad has a PS5 that you play all the time. So stop with this other system stuff. But you know what? It's up to Santa, I guess. So it's out of my hands. Who knows?
That's right. Well, it's up to Callaway and the rest of the crew to, you know, that they've behaved this year.
They better. Well, yeah, that's something we work on every day, Cody. Appreciate the time, man. Stay warm as best you can today. We'll hear you on the broadcast and enjoy the game, and we'll talk to you again in the future.
All right, buddy. Sounds good.
Thank you. That is Cody Junot on a Give Me All You Got Friday. Now, originally, I was supposed to have on Justin and Austin Robichaux to talk about their late, great Tony Robichaux, Coach Robe, and his book and a number of other things. But we had to push that interview back. We'll do that sometime in January. But that's going to do it for me on these airwaves for a while. I am going to be taking next week off. I will be back on January the 4th. And Blaze and Nick will be holding it down. We'll have tons of great morning shows for you next week. We will have plenty of bowl games for you on our airwaves. Obviously, you know, UL Hoops. And obviously, today's Independence Bowl. Enjoy it. And to everybody out there that's listening, whether it's live, whether it's via the podcast, wherever you are, have a safe and Merry Christmas for those who celebrate. Happy holidays to all. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. I appreciate you guys more than you know. All the best. This is The Great Scott Show. I'm Scott Prather. This is 103.3 The GOAT, simulcast on 1420. It's The GOAT, the greatest sports talk of all time.